The information contained in this podcast is an expression of opinion and does not constitute investment advice. This is the Gold Money Foundation podcast with Andy Duncan, keeping you up to date with expert opinion on precious metals and the markets.
Okay, hello and welcome to another Gold Money Foundation podcast from here at the Mises Institute in Auburn, Alabama, at the Austrian Economics Research Conference. Today I've got the great pleasure to be with Professor Gerard Casey, who's a Professor of Philosophy from University College Dublin. Hello, Gerard.
Hello, Andy. How are you?
Tip top. Now, I wanted to go into your kind of philosophical basis and your philosophical kind of studies. You have particular views, very defined views on property, and we'll develop those views. But first of all, can you tell us about your views on property?
Right. Well, it's really a link to justice. If you go back, for example, to say very young children arguing over who's got the toy and so on, they have very sharply defined notions, inchoate and not reflective, but nonetheless notions of what's mine and what's yours. And in fact, any civilized society has to have notions of what is mine and what is yours. Now, of course, they'll draw the lines in different places and these will develop historically. But as you move, say, from very early human history, from hunter-gatherers who have sort of very loose and porous notions of boundaries, when you move to the agricultural revolution, If you have a hunting ground, it's perfectly possible for other people to be using it at different times, so on. But if you want to grow a crop and you want to clear a field and it involves cutting down trees and picking up stones and so on, your investment there is not just for one crop, when you're going to move on. You're making a long-term investment. So the notion of external property really develops in that kind of context. And, of course, your neighbours are doing the same thing, and eventually it's mutual recognition of these mutual rights which give rise to the notion of property. And, you know, the common saying, good fences make good neighbours, that's what does it. You need a notion of property. Of course, we have an original notion of property in our own bodies as well, which links into the whole thing. So every civilised society needs a notion, a working notion of property. Without that, you've got chaos.
Yeah, internal and external notions, which can be all combined into one. Yeah. Now, I just wanted to move on then to money itself. Now, money is a peculiar substance. It's a peculiar property. Does money have any other properties as property, if that's not too much, which make it different from normal property, like a cup of coffee or an ice cream or anything?
Yeah, well, as the politicians say, I'm glad you asked me that. and the reason being that my descent into the abyss of libertarianism and anarchism started by my reflections on the notion of money. As a philosopher, I was very puzzled, not only by the fact that I never seem to have enough of this, maybe because I'm a philosopher, but the very notion of what it is, you have this rather dirty and piece of paper in your wallet, and people, for some strange reason, are willing to give you goods and services for this. Now, of course, here's the really puzzling thing. If I were to get my really super-duper printing press and produce a facsimile of this and go around, then I'm going to be hauled up. Now, what's the actual difference between the piece of paper for which people are willing to give me goods and services and the piece of paper which looks identical in every respect, for which they're not? And that's a really puzzling answer, because they have all the same physical properties.
Yeah.
Right? Now, the difference is, as we know, that in the modern world, one of them has the sanction of a state or government, and it's, and so on. So my particular piece of reproduction is counterfeiting. Yeah. Right? But in fact, there's a very peculiar idea, because in a certain sense, almost all paper money is counterfeit.
Yeah.
Really. It's just that there is a monopoly in counterfeiting.
Well, what's even funny about it, if the Bank of England does a printing run and produces a £5 note, that's proper money. But if they turn the lights off and go away and you come in the middle of the night, use their printing press and print up
paper,
a few extra ones, which they don't know about, that's counterfeit money.
Exactly.
That's really strange.
It's a really bizarre notion. But money is an odd thing. And as we know, money effectively is anything, any entity that people are willing to take in exchange for goods or services in a general way. We know how it developed, and we know how it develops even in modern times, for example, so people have used throughout history have used tobacco and wampum and stones and leaves and so on. And of course, in the prison camps in the Second World War, people used packs, unopened packs of cigarettes as money. So if you didn't have to be a smoker, you kept your packet of cigarettes intact and you traded it for food, and so it became the entity which had the greatest exchange value,
yeah,
and therefore it becomes money. So anything, in effect, can be money. So the grubby pieces of paper I have in my pocket, they're not gold, but actually they are money because in whether you like them or not, and I don't particularly like them, okay, no libertarian does, are nonetheless money because they are, in effect, accepted for goods and services in exchange. Yeah. So it's a very peculiar kind of thing.
Yeah, all of us, even the Austrian professors at a university, will take these paper notes because they know they can get goods and services.
But even more mysteriously, I've never really thought this through because I got so sidetracked when I started down this line of inquiry. Right now, most of our money is even more notional than paper. When you think of how many exchanges take place which involve simply adjusting numbers on the screen.
Yeah.
Somewhere in my, I'm paid directly into my bank account. Almost all my purchases, all my payments for my services are all done using cards. And there's no physical transaction. No money, as it were, in physical sense, changes hands.
Yeah.
Very peculiar.
Yeah, I mean, I've come to America this week and I've hardly used any paper dollar notes. Everything's been just cards. And
yeah, I've done this. I have the same. In fact, I have money in my wallet from last year when I was here, which I didn't spend, and I'm not getting much opportunity to spend it either.
Yeah. Now that we've kind of got to the root of money, the strange properties of money, what about the violation of property in terms of Cyprus? Now, as we speak, it's March the 23rd, Saturday the 23rd of March. The violations of property in Cyprus, what do you think of that?
Well, there are a number of ways in which you can remove people's goods from them. You can, stick a gun to their heads and take it from them. And it's quite obvious. Taxation is an obvious and relatively unpopular way of taking money from people because they see what's being done. Of course, inflation is the silent thief. Yeah. In other words, if you have 10,000 euros in your bank account today and the inflation rate is running at 10%, then, gradually the actual value of your money is decreasing. Nominally, you still have the same money, but it doesn't feel quite the same. You think, well, I've still got 10,000 euros in my account, but you don't, right? So the governments from the very beginning have used all sorts of methods to debase currency, obviously mixing the coinage and adding silver or adding copper or impure metals and clipping around the edges and so on and so forth. But of course, in the electronic era, right, it's much easier to do it. And so it's very hard for anybody, if you like, to find a safe place or a refuge for their stored wealth, because it's like while gold doesn't rust, paper money inflates.
Yeah.
All you need to do is for the money supply to double for your existing store of money to be worth half of what it was worth the day before.
It seems odd in Cyprus because the ECB could easily just print up or electronically create the digits and some binary switches inside a computer and give the Cypriot government an infinite amount. They could give them a trillion euros, 10 trillion euros just by moving some binary digits around a computer. Yeah, they seem to have gone for the more old-fashioned kind of wealth acquisition, confiscation. By first of all, planning to take 10%. I don't know how the plans at the moment, as we're speaking,
are up in the air,
everything above 100,000 euros, 40%, everything below, okay, because they're all Cypriot voters. So why do you think the ECB, the EU and the IMF have gone to an older form of confiscation rather than the silent confiscation of quantitative easing?
Well, I'm a bit puzzled, actually, about this. The short answer is, I think they can do it and get away with it. They are so confident in their ability to bring all national governments to heel. They've done it in Ireland, they've done it in Greece, they're doing it in Spain and Italy, that they think they can do it here. And I think they were a little bit surprised that the Cypriot Parliament rejected their proposals, which seemed obviously eminently reasonable to them. I mean, when I first became aware of this, as I did on a popular blog, I think about a week ago, I thought this was a joke.
Yeah.
And the thought that all of the bright minds of Europe sitting around a table would say, we've got a problem with our banking system. We need people to put their money into banks. Yeah. So here's a really great idea.
Let's steal
10% of the money. This is really going to... Now, suddenly, everybody in the country, everybody in the European Union is going to rush out and put their money into the banks. It's really peculiar. And then we got all of this bizarre stuff about Russian money laundering stuff. And I was thinking, well, hang on a second. If that was really true, first of all, why weren't you doing something about it already? And if it is really true, why aren't you doing something about it now? Don't you have laws to address those things? And isn't the idea that it's those who commit the crimes who are meant to be punished, not the innocent bystanders? Yeah. This is very peculiar. And of course, we now have a little bit of brinkmanship acted out, presumably on Monday. Yeah. And I think this is what it is. I think the EU sees that if Cyprus, as it were, can get away with this, then they're going to be faced with something like a mini, or even maybe slightly more than a mini revolution on their hands, fiscally anyway, around the EU. Certainly, for example, in Ireland, where we have been the good boys of Europe, where our own neo-colonial government, because that's what it is, who on instructions from Europe are putting the boot in to the Irish population, may suddenly find that the Irish population are a little less supine than they have been.
Yeah. Is it 35% wage cuts for public sector workers?
Well, it varies. It depends on what you're earning. But I mean, I'll give my own example because it's the one I want. So the people in academia took a 10% pay cut straight off. People on my level, on professorial level, are paying between 8 and 10% pension levy. Right, which has nothing to do.
That's nice, isn't it?
Which is great for a pension I've already paid for anyway.
Yeah.
Then there's the universal social charge, which is about 5 to 7%. Again, it depends. And then, of course, there are there's been the inflation and so on. So when you add it all up, it comes to about probably around 28 to 30%. Now we have the government putting a gun to our head, saying you're going to take effectively a 7 to 8% cut again on top of that, or else.
Yeah.
Ooh, and it's that or else.
What's the or else?
Well, the or else is we'll do it by law anyway. In other words, unless you agree to it
voluntarily. Agree to it or we'll do it anyway.
Agree to it or we'll do it anyway. And I thought, I'm a member of the Irish Federation of University Teachers, which is our representative body, and I said, you shouldn't go into discussions with a gun to your head like that. Yeah.
Sounds like Tony Blair. He used to do that kind of thing. I want industry to voluntarily agree to this, otherwise I'll do it anyway.
Well, you might say, well, what's in it for them? And the answer is because if they can say, even though everybody knows it's a fiction, that we agree to it, then they get some kind of moral credit for it. If they have to legislate, then the naked hand of raw power has to reveal itself, and they'd rather not do that.
Yeah. Coming back to the Cyprus effect, I want you to just pretend. Let's imagine that you have 10 million euros in an Irish bank.
hang on a second, I'm doing a lot of imagining here.
Now, you're flying back to Ireland, presumably, in the next couple of days. You've got this 10 million euros sitting in a bank account in Ireland. What are you going to do with it because of what's the Cypriot thing going to make you do?
It's going to make me take my money out.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I can tell you, I don't have 10 million, but I have a little bit. And you know what I did on the day after I heard about this announcement?
Yeah.
I took my money out.
Yeah.
The little bit I have. It's not much, okay? And I'm not going to be losing a fortune, but I figured those swine, pardon my expression, it's a technical term, are not going to get any of this.
So are you going for the mattresses now? The 10%
well,
premium?
Well, yeah, the 10% premium in mattresses. Well, especially when I heard our Minister of Finance say in his inimitable Limerick accent, of course, this will only apply to one country and it's only a once-off measure. I thought, yes, that inspires me with confidence.
Yeah.
Right. Of course, I mean, there is a plus to this in a sense that whatever agreement they cobble together, whatever happens as the result of this brinkmanship. The EU has been revealed as a number of things. One is incompetent, because this is a completely idiotic move on their part. But secondly, it has shown once again that no property, okay, no money, no deposits, no accounts, nothing, and none of this is safe anywhere. There is no hiding place in the EU. Whatever they want, okay, they will find some way to take from you.
Yeah.
Okay. And I hope that this may be seen to be the beginning of the end of the evil empire, which is the European empire, and that we might get back to something for which I voted in 1973, which is the European Economic Community.
Yeah.
I voted for that. I voted consistently against every treaty after that.
Yeah. Yeah, and people in Ireland used to keep being given a vote until they got the answer right.
Yeah, because we're stupid. We tend to get the wrong answer the first time around.
Have another go until you get it right. In Cyprus, we've got this... they're now the favourites to leave the euro. They've sprung out of nowhere to replace Greece.
Yeah.
Now, if Cyprus does leave, this brinkmanship policy fails from the EU, and Cyprus does leave the euro, do you think the euro is going to have a kind of implode immediately, or do you think it will last a bit longer?
Well, who can say? My guess is, again, given the amount that people have invested in all of this, and people really prefer a stability that's non-optimal to a chaos that might eventually result in a slightly more optimal situation, my guess is it will probably absorb the evil effects or the destructive effects and carry on, but it will certainly be injured. There's no question about it.
Yes.
Because this was the great project. This was the euro was the great project, if you like, leading to undergird the eventual political unification.
Yeah.
Right? And people have been saying for a long time that you cannot have a unified currency without a unitary state, in a sense. And while I'm no great advocate, obviously, of the unitary state, there seems to be a certain truth in that here, that the political mechanisms necessary to ensure the stability of the euro aren't in place and haven't been in place. And as we've seen, certainly since the introduction of the euro, the two major players in Europe, Germany and France, have, as they, whenever they wished, manipulated or used monetary policy to achieve their own particular ends, whether or not that was for the good of the other EU states or not.
Yeah. Now we'll just have to look forward to Monday, I suppose.
Well, yes, with some excited anticipation and some trepidation, because unfortunately I feel a bit like somebody who is in the temple when Samson was doing his stuff. I'd prefer to be outside watching this, okay? Yeah. But unfortunately, I happen to live under the cover of the euro, and my money is in it or not. You guys are in a much better position, with the pound, but I'm in there. And so, in a way, I obviously don't wish the destruction of myself or my livelihood or my money and so on, but if it's got to happen, and if it's the beginning of the re-achievement of some kind of sovereignty, limited as that might be, then I'll accept it.
Yeah, but of course the listeners to this program will have known what will have happened, because this will be coming out after,
Then.
So, they'll
what happened?
Talking to the future. Now, let's just shift gears. You've written a book about Murray Rothbard, and we're in his kind of spiritual home here, which
Indeed.
Is the Mises Institute. What was your book about Murray Rothbard?
Well, it came about sort of accidentally. And John Meadowcroft in King's College London is the general editor of a series called Major Conservative and Libertarian Thinkers. Mm-hmm. And he and I were conversing about something. I can't quite remember what. And he was telling me about the series and then said, asked me if I knew anybody I could recommend to write this book. And of course, I said, me.
Yeah.
And so I did, because, since I was turned on to all of this stuff back in about 2004, 2005, I've been a big admirer of Murray. So the series has a sort of a template. And so the first short chapter is sort of Life and Times. The second major chapter, which is almost half the book, really is about his political and ethical philosophy. I don't go into his economics, because this is a book on conservatism and libertarianism rather than on economics.
Yeah.
The third chapter deals with his critics and the reception of his work. I don't think anybody's done that. That may be the most novel part of the book. And then finally, it's kind of looking forward and where do we go from here?
Yeah.
So it was kind of fun to write that, and it forced me to read those parts of Rothbard's opus that I hadn't read before.
Yeah.
This is great.
Now when this book was first published, because it's been out a while, it was in hardback and it costs about £1 million.
Yeah, well, we'll do up after Monday.
But I've heard that, yeah. They'll just print some more money to buy lots of copies. But it is coming out in paperback, and hopefully the price will reduce massively.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I had around January, I wrote to my publisher and said, hello, since nobody's read this book, is there any possibility we would get an independent publisher to bring it out in paperback? And he said, oh, forgot to tell you, we're bringing the series out in paperback. The first 10 volumes have come out this month, that was January, and the second 10 volumes, including yours, will come out in August. So it'll be available for about $25 or $26 or something like that.
So what's the name of the book?
The book is just called Murray Rothbard. Yeah. That's just the title.
And who's the publisher?
And the publisher is Continuum, or now Bloomsbury, because Bloomsbury have taken over Continuum.
Now, I read your recent other book, Libertarian Anarchy. It's a fantastic book.
Oh, thank you.
So I haven't read this book because I couldn't afford it the first time around.
I couldn't afford it.
But I'll be buying a copy then once I can get it for that super low price. I'm sure it'll be a worthwhile investment. Now, if you've read the whole of the Rothbard opus, Rothbard to me is an absolute genius. But what do you think is a good path for people to access Rothbard? What's your sort of top three books for someone who's new to Rothbard to read in sequence?
Well, okay, it depends primarily on what your interests are. If your interests are in the kind of political philosophy side, then I think The Ethics of Liberty is where you go. It's 200 pages plus. It's got a lot of short chapters. It's pithy. It's well written. Not everything is sort of rounded off and finished so that you can't get a grip. There's lots of controversial material in there. It's challenging. Yeah. I use this in my course with my upper level undergraduates.
Yeah.
And it's really, really good to read. For the economics, you probably don't want to start with Man, Economy, and State.
It's too big a cliff.
1,600 pages. It gives you a sort of mental and physical hernia.
Yeah.
Okay. But you could use some of the shorter works, particularly, for example, if you're interested in money or banking, there's three or four works. There, he has two works on. There's the Panic of 1819, and then there's the one on the 1929 stuff. So there's a lot of material. If you're interested in the more technical, kind of philosophical, economic musings, there's a two-volume edition of papers. I can't quite remember the name. I think it's The Logic of Action, one and two. Okay, you can read that. But then there's this wonderful, I think it's a page-turner, his two-volume History of Economic Thought.
Oh, that's a brilliant book.
Two brilliant books. Yeah. And each of them about 500 pages. But, you know, there's so much stuff in there. It reads like a novel. You find yourself turning those pages really fast.
I just wish he could have lived long enough to write the third volume.
It would have been great. So there's, in a way, so as I say, if it's Ethics of Politics, then The Ethics of Liberty, with For a New Liberty bringing up a kind of close second. Any of the shorter works in economics, maybe the stuff on, you know, what's the Fed done to our money and that sort of thing, will get you started and you can lead on from there.
Yeah. So I'd go from What Has the Government Done to Our Money to then The Mystery of Banking and then maybe Man, Economy, and State.
That's right.
Once I'm feeling...
Yeah, but you're feeling strong. You need to build up your strength. Okay. Yeah.
Now, so that's Rothbard covered. Now, just to wrap up, you're famous for, in our circles, for a lot of kind of Catholic thought. What do you think of the recent papal situation?
Well, first of all, I was away somewhere, I got a phone call from RTE, or national station, and they wanted me to come on to talk about the resignation of Pope Benedict. I was away, and I got back as a matter of courtesy to the researchers the next day, and I apologized, and we started to talk. And she said, what would have been your line if you had been able to come on to the program? And I said, well, I would have expressed extreme disappointment. Mm. I would have said, this sets a dangerous precedent and I'm not at all in favour. No disrespect intended to Pope Benedict. Okay, he was a man of many virtues, but I think this was an ill-advised and ill-considered decision on his part. So that's the first thing. As for the new man, well, I'm immensely amused by the secular commentators on this, all of whom say things like, will the new Pope change doctrine so that we will, you know, be in favour of abortion and women priests? And I go, you guys are more ultramontane than I am. Okay? I mean, even...
I wish I knew what that meant.
Ultramontane, the 19th century thought that, you know, the Pope could effectively do whatever he wanted and so on. Yeah. And, I mean, the Pope can't do these things. In other words, he's not a prime minister with a policy or, you know, with an agenda that he can do all of these things. The Pope operates within very strict limits and so on. He can give, now within that, he can give certain sort of directions. And I have to say, frankly, as a libertarian, the words social and justice in combination are the kind of things that induce fear and trembling in me. And so we wait to see how this is going to turn out.
Yeah,
I wish him all the best, obviously, as a Catholic and so on. But I'm slightly apprehensive.
We'll see how it goes.
We'll see how it goes.
Anyway, Gerard, it's been Professor Gerard Casey. It's been absolutely fantastic talking to you today. Thank you for your time, I look forward to reading your book in August.
All right, very good. Thank you, Andy.
Subscribe to the Gold Money newsletter at www.goldmoney.com. to receive email updates on new articles, videos, and iTunes podcasts from our Gold Research section.
And we'll develop those views. But first of all, can you tell us about your views on property?
Right. Well, it's really linked to justice. If you, even if you go back, for example, to, say, very young children, arguing over who's got the toy and so on, they have very closely, they have very sharply defined notions, inchoate and not reflective, but nonetheless notions of what's mine and what's yours. And in fact, any civilized society has to have notions of what is mine and what is yours. Now, of course, they'll draw the lines in different places and these will develop historically. But as you move, say, from very early human history, from hunter-gatherers who have sort of very loose and porous notions of boundaries, when you move to the...
The information contained in this podcast is an expression of opinion and does not constitute investment advice. This is the Gold Money Foundation podcast with Andy Duncan, keeping you up to date with expert opinion on precious metals and the markets.
Okay, hello and welcome to another Gold Money Foundation podcast from here at the Mises Institute in Auburn, Alabama, at the Austrian Economics Research Conference. Today I've got the great pleasure to be with Professor Gerard Casey, who's a Professor of Philosophy from University College Dublin. Hello, Gerard.
Hello, Andy. How are you?
Tip top. Now, I wanted to go into your kind of philosophical basis and your philosophical kind of studies. You have particular views, very defined views on property.
Notion of money. As a philosopher, I was very puzzled, not only by the fact that I never seem to have enough of this, maybe because I'm a philosopher, but the very notion of what it is, you have this rather dirty and piece of paper in your wallet, and people, for some strange reason, are willing to give you goods and services for this. Now, of course, here's the really puzzling thing. If I were to get my really super-duper printing press and produce a facsimile of this and go around, then I'm going to be hauled up. Now, what's the actual difference between the piece of paper for which people are willing to give me goods and services and the piece of paper, which looks identical in every respect, for which they're not? And that's a really puzzling agricultural revolution. When you, for example... Okay, let me start again. If you have a hunting ground, it's perfectly possible for other people to be using it at different times, and so on. But if you want to grow a crop and you want to clear a field and it involves cutting down trees and picking up stones and so on, your investment there is not just for one crop, when you're going to move on. You're making a long-term investment. So the notion of external property really develops in that kind of context. And, of course, your neighbours are doing the same thing, and eventually it's mutual recognition of these mutual rights, which give rise to the notion of property. And, the common saying, good fences make good neighbours, that's what does it. You need a notion of property. Of course, we have an original notion of property in our own bodies as well, which links into the whole thing. So every civilised society needs a notion, a working notion of property. Without that, you've got chaos.
Yeah, internal and external notions, which can be all combined into one. Yeah. Now, I just wanted to move on then to money itself. Now, money is a peculiar substance. It's a peculiar property. Does money have any other properties as property, if that's not too much, which make it different from normal property, like a cup of coffee or an ice cream or anything?
Yeah, well, as the politicians say, I'm glad you asked me that. and the reason being that my descent into the abyss of libertarianism and anarchism started by my reflections on the